It's great to see you. Your hair is growing in, and I mean, all of this is growing in anyway, but the hair on your head is like almost back.
It's almost back. We went very, very severe early.
I saw.
We have now kind of decided to see what's on the other side of growing out. Who knows?
Who does?
But I cannot rock the clean look like you can, my friend. You set a very high standard for the community.
I will take it. but the reason I have to rock it is because back in 1996, after I played Belize and Angels in America and they had put extensions in my hair, the place where it was sort of glued onto my scalp would not grow.
No.
And so I started shaving my head back in 96.
Oh, a my long time goodness. Ago. That's a story.
So many things happened when I did that.
Wow. That's insane.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, it's okay. It's fine. I'm not sad.
You look great.
Well, thank you. I had to be at a benefit for the Neo Futurists tonight.
Yeah.
And I had to make a little speech. And before that, I was on this thing for the York because I was in a show at the York back in 2000. And they were doing like, they had the whole cast and... Anyway, I just felt like I needed to look appropriate for both of those things. Yeah. I apologize for not having enough time to remove all of this for both of you.
No, how dare you? You look great. What's going on? Travis, hello.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, Travis.
Hi, nice to meet you.
It's very nice to meet you. I'm so excited that we're going to have this conversation. My Zoom is already recording us, just so you know. I will discard... that when you start brewing tea about people, I will discard all of that.
Okay, good.
But I will keep it for myself.
That's great.
The world doesn't need to know all the tea, right. But I definitely would love to know most of it. Okay. You know what the reparation show is, but I just need to say out loud the thing that I say to everyone about the reparation show is that it was created after George Floyd was murdered. Era Ziv, who created it, who asked me, do you want to do a show for Black and Indigenous artists to make art or to do art or do whatever they want, and have white artists support them and not pay the white artists somehow? And I was like, you mean like a reparation show? And he said, well, yeah, I guess. And I said, well, I don't think that we can tell white artists that we're not going to pay them. But I do think we can ask white artists to donate their time. And so if they agree to donate their time, then they'll donate their time. But if they don't agree to donate their time, then they'll have less time on the show. and we'll still pay them for being on the show. So I don't say that to say, Graham, do you donate your time? I do say that just to say that's basically what the genesis of the reparation show was. And where it has gone is that it's basically, I have entered the most thoughtful time of my life. And I think a lot of us have. And I don't believe that the government will give us the millions of dollars that we are owed for building, for being the backbone of this country from years and years and years ago. But I do think that I can repair my relationships with my colleagues. And I do think that I can try to repair my relationship to myself and my relationship to the art that I create. And my particular journey during all of this has been to repair my relationships with Black women, because I feel like as a Black queer artist who lost his mother at a very young age, that I make a lot of work that is angry with Black women. And that's all my own personal abandonment issues. And I didn't know that until 2017, 2018. But I'm using the show for me as a way to really think about that and create that space. So anyway, that is what the reparation show is. There is a different host every week. I'm on for a segment to sort of unify the show every week. And that is... so that I can come on and say thank you for doing the show. And sometimes I have people on that I talk to about different things, like I'm going to do with you guys, with you folks. So that's basically it. So how you doing tonight?
I'm great. Thank you for sharing that too. That's really beautiful, and thank you for opening the space in that way.
Well, thank you. When I say how you doing, I just want to check in to see what you're bringing in the moment, in energetically too.
I'm doing okay. I'm fine. I'm a little tired, but I'm okay. I'm thinking about a lot of stuff. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about a lot of like artistic stuff and a lot of just like mental and physical growing that I need to be doing right now in this pandemic time. Yeah. So that's what I'm bringing, but I'm happy to talk. I'm excited.
Excellent. And Graham, what are you bringing in this space besides hair?
Today's been I'm just taking things a day at a time. Today has been a really great day. I got to have a conversation with I'm a guest artist for an NYU playwriting course. And this play that she wrote feels like it really, I had a very impactful therapy session on Tuesday where I realized that my therapist, whatever, maybe this is tea, whatever. My therapist declared that you are riddled with doubt about whether or not you are lovable, and you also doubt whether or not you doubt the sincerity of people who profess to love you. Mm. And that was like,
yeah,
that's so in a way it felt very sad, but also like that felt very true about me, and that I get to now engage with that problem.
Yeah. Would you say that that describes the experience of an artist in the United States?
Yeah, being an artist didn't help, right? Travis and I had a teacher, Stephen Dietz,
Lonely Planet.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. Lonely Planet, among many other plays.
Isn't he the one that's married to Joe Mantello?
No. He's married to Allison Gregory.
Gross.
I don't.
To a woman.
But no, he's very straight. He's very much a dude.
Yeah, he's very straight. that's hilarious because we've known him for a time and. I think he would be happy to think that you thought he was married to Joe Mantello.
I mean, well, you know what's funny is that what I really thought was that he was divorced from Joe Mantello, which of course makes perfect sense to me. Now that's tea.
I kind of want to start that rumor now.
Yeah, that's the tea is that people are saying.
And anyhow, I'm sorry, you were saying Stephen Dietz.
He used to say that theater doesn't love you back. Like you do all this work and the payoff, you're always playing a long game, and theater, as an institution will be around whether or not you're doing the work, and also you'll invest enormous sums of labor, and the payout you get will be meager. And then also I think that we're confronting the ways in which theater as an institution is also just like hostile to the artists who give it, lifeblood in ways that it's like racist, it's sexist, all those things.
I also think that the theater teaches us to be that way towards one another, unless we are, unless there's a moment for us to stop and think that we are made up of people and that we are all trying to get a tiny piece of pie, and that to extend the metaphor, we're not ever going to be satisfied until we give up sugar, right? It's like it's not gonna my new philosophy is to be sure that I am really taking care of the people with whom I'm working, whether that means I'm cooking them meals and bringing them to them, or sliding a couple of bucks as a surprise in a Venmo, or just listening to what they have to say. And also knowing that I am not competing for any of the things that they told us that we had to compete for. That my whole thing is that I don't actually need you in the way that I thought I did, powers that be. I don't need you in the ways that I thought that I did, partly because I've never received the shine that some of the others have received, who have treated me with un treated me unkindly. And that is not to say that people have treated me unkindly, and I'm not bitter or angry about any of that. I'm just saying that there has come a time in my life now where I recognize, Graham, I think you might have engaged with my tweet storm about Charles Randolph Wright on Twitter. He in college, when I was in college, he sued me because,
Yes,
yeah.
yes.
And so, which sort of led me to not ever have a black male mentor. And for me, not, and, but I, because of the pandemic and because of the way that I kept working when it all shut down, and that being so surprising to me, the idea that I had access to publishers who would allow me to record their books and blah 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 made me think, oh, back in 1988 when Charles Randolph Wright sued me, he was caught up in that in the system. He was caught up in the capitalist system and was broke and desperate and didn't know what to do, and that is why he did that. And now I have to talk about that out loud so that I can say I get this now, and it is not a shameful secret that wasn't, because I believed all these years not getting a Broadway show was that I was unworthy and that somehow he was right to have sued me. And while he was right to sue the university, he was not right to name me in the lawsuit. And also, they should have paid him. He should have had, we were a student-run organization and the university should have given him money to do the thing. And but that thing that was ruinous, I thought, ruinous to my career and my psyche, that thing happened because of circumstances that there were some that were under his control. We're not going to let him completely off the hook. But also, I get where he was because I've been there. And now that I'm not there, I just want to make sure that we are all taking care of one another.
It's a matter of, it feels like it's a matter of like refusing to participate in a cycle whereby artists, and particularly black artists, this reminds me of the whole conversation that Montana started with his, I don't know if you saw his IG live about Williamstown Theater Festival in Montana, the costume designer. But just, I hesitate to speak on behalf of black artists, but there is a sense in which theater forces us to carry around these wounds and to,
I
to
mean,
wear them.
yeah, I think this is an interesting conversation just because that LA Times article just came out about
I
like the 40 different artists,
yeah.
like, and I read it and I was like, oh yeah, all of these things have happened to me already. Like, on all of these examples have happened to every black artist. Like, this article's not for black artists, it's for like white theater artists and other
Yes.
theater artists that are not black to like recognize like, oh, the burden that you're discussing right now. It's like, this is a whole system that's holding this up, that's saying, telling Lynn Nottage that her work is not viable to sell somewhere, like,
Right.
of all people.
Right.
Yeah.
It's I think there it's interesting because some of those artists that are in that article also are people, as a person who has worked for years with black artists and to make them, for these small organizations like the Fire This Time Festival, where we're when I used to run the organization, we were scratching to get by every year. And some of the playwrights who came from that organization, who went on to be, don't turn around and say nice things about the festival, put us in the bio, because a lot of us are trying to get those white institutions to give us some kind of shine. Because we're thinking that that's the only way. And when I think about how Tony Kushner said, yeah, I had to stop writing plays because I couldn't make a living. I just couldn't make a living at it. I had to do movies and television. I just had to do that. And for him to say, I'm not participating in the theater thing because I can't make any money doing theater. And for Black artists now to say, even some of them to not turn around and say, hey, Fire This Time Festival, hey, National Black Theater, I want to give you the world premiere of my new play. And I'm going to find the people who are going to give us the money so that we can make this a big world premiere celebration, is the gaslighting that makes us think that we have to grab for that brass ring that doesn't actually exist in the way that we think it does. Because I look at Lynn Nottage and I think, Lynn Nottage, 2-time Pulitzer Prize winner, she can get whatever she wants. But when her play Left the Guthrie and was going to open at Second Stage, they fired an actor because the actor wasn't famous enough, Johanna Day, which is sort of like, wait. And Lynn didn't have the power to make her stay, like, what? So I'm going to take a quick moment to let my cats out because they are eating in a room and I had there are too many cats in my house.
Yeah.
And 2 of them have to be locked up so that they don't eat the old cat's food. I'll be right back, and then we will start this interview for real. Okay.
Great. Hey, Travis.
Hey, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm fine, I'm just tired. I'm tired, tired, tired. I don't know why. Yeah. You know.
How's Arizona?
I don't care that you couldn't see. I don't care that you could see that I was wearing sweats.
I just have this awful nightmare that, like, I've been doing lots of job interviews because I need a job that pays money.
Yeah.
That they're going to be like, stand up. And I'm going to have to, like, stand up and, like, be like Jim Schwartz, but like a full dress top.
Can you imagine? Oh my God. That would be the worst. Well, you just have to tell them, I could stand up, but my support animal is at my feet.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Okay, so I think the frame of the conversation, really it should just be a free-flowing conversation, but I think it should be about the two of you telling the story of how you met. So I will ask you, so how did you meet? Tell me the story of what happened with the play and your experiences with one another. And then I will... Is that you?
That's me.
You're in Brooklyn?
I'm in Brooklyn.
All this police presence. God.
Oh, we're at the most policed intersection, I feel.
That is incredible. Loud. How do you sleep? Okay.
Antoinette doesn't. Anyway.
Yeah. Well, okay. I didn't until I discovered cannabis. So. gummies. I can't smoke anything. So. Just so you know, that tea, it's recorded. Everybody knows. And then I will ask Graham to talk about your experience of stepping down from directing the play.
Sure.
And then we'll talk about what your relationship is post that. I mean, I think Travis, you can talk about too, about the decision, how you came to make the decision together. I'm pointing at you like you can see, like we're in the same room. This Zoom has become a real thing. Cool. Okay, great. So I will lead you. I'll ask you to identify yourselves and all that kind of stuff. And then, yeah. Okay. 3, 2, 1. Hi, Travis and Graham. Thank you so much for coming on the Reparations Show. It's really great to see your faces. I'm so happy that you are here with me in these little boxes. Introduce yourselves and tell everybody who you are, what you do. Let's start with Graham.
Great. My name is Graham Schmidt. Thank you for having us, Kevin. This is awesome. My name is Graham Schmidt. I'm a Brooklyn-based theater director. I've lived here for about 2 years, and I also teach acting, and I'm a freelance dramaturg.
And Travis?
Hi, I'm Travis Tate. I am a playwright and a poet, and sometimes I perform things. I'm based in a liminal space right now, so that's where I'm at.
A liminal space. Does the liminal space have a name? Is it like Jewel World? Is it Tate World? What is it called?
It's my mom's house, what is what it's called. Yeah.
My mom's house. Well, that's a good place to be. That is a good place to be. So tell me how you know each other.
Me and Graham met in grad school in 2015. We
A
both lived
world, a
in
lifetime
Austin.
ago, a lifetime ago.
Forever.
2015. Good Lord. Okay.
Yeah, it feels like a very long time, 5 years ago. Yeah.
Jesus. Yeah.
We could walk around and do things. Yeah, we met in Austin, Texas at UT in grad school, and we were both living in Austin before that, but I don't think we had met before then.
We met, it was a small cohort. There were five people. And so it was a pretty intense experience over the course of the next 3 years.
And was it you were getting an MFA in directing or in playwriting or just in making theater?
The program is the MFA in playwriting and directing. So
Oh.
both disciplines study together. And so there were two directors and three playwrights our year, but usually it's either one director and four playwrights or somewhere around that.
I
It's,
see. So it's sort of a program that creates collaborators.
I think so. Yeah, it's really based in grounded in new work. And I got into some devising practices when I was there because it was, I think Kirk Lynn is, it was one of the founders of the Rude Mechanicals. He has a big influence on the curriculum, and there was a lot of viewpoints and Suzuki kind of work there as well.
Wow. So the two of you were part of this cohort, and did that mean then that Travis, you were writing a lot of plays that the directors in the cohort were directing? Or did you go outside of the program for directors?
Mostly, like Graham's mentioned, it was a big program about collaboration and new work. So not all the directors were directing the playwright's work, but that's basically how it happened. Like you'd write a play, and if you wanted a reading, you'd ask Graham or one of the other directors in your cohort or in the previous, years. And yeah, so we weren't, I mean, there was lots of time and space to do things in Austin, but when you're in grad school, it's easier to ask the person next to you. So yeah, that's basically how it happened. If you wanted a play done or, a little production or a reading or anything, kind of work on it, you would work with directors in the cohort or dramaturgs in the other cohorts, other people like that, yeah.
And so my question to you now is, how often did the two of you work together in grad school?
Not a ton. I directed a couple of readings of Travis's, and we studied together. But we were friends outside of that. We didn't never ne never collaborated directly during grad school.
And during grad school, was there a reason for that?
I don't think so. Like, if,
Wait, hold on, let me ask Travis.
yeah, Travis, what do you think?
Travis, was there a reason why Graham never d really directed your stuff in grad school?
I honestly, I don't think so. I think, like Graham kind of mentioned about, like I mean, we would like weekly have our drinks and like hang out, and so we were pretty friendly. And I would have asked, but I don't think there's any reason. To be completely honest, if I was making work about Black people or queer people, I may not have wanted to necessarily ask Graham first. But and then our resources were limited in the program, and so I don't know. I mean, he directed some readings, and that was, I got to work with him, but I don't know. There wasn't any like bad reason.
I was just trying to make you brew some tea before we actually get to the actual tea of this con the meat of this conversation. But I will segue into that right now. So, you have a play called Queen of the Night. What is it called?
Yes, it's called Queen of the Night.
Oh, great! You know what? I thought that it was. I'm sorry. This is just a sidebar. There, they made a musical called The Queen of the Night, I think that everybody was confused about because they thought it was like the Queen of the Night song from The Bodyguard. And
Oh,
so
wasn't
when,
it as a vampire thing? Maybe
yes, I think it was. I mean, I'm always very confused because Deborah Cox was doing the Bodyguard, the musical at some point, and then but then I like would always picture of her singing Queen of the Night, you know, whatever. Anyway, okay. 3-2 and also one. So, Travis, you have a play called Queen of the Night, and you and Graham have collaborated on this play off and on, or has it been continuous for a number of years?
I think probably in our last year of grad school, we started to explore working on it and talking about it, and Graham kind of directing slash dramaturging it. And yeah, so it's probably been a year-ish too.
And
But
can you go ahead?
I haven't been the only director who had, like, Travis had a workshop in Austin and then moved to New York in, I guess it was February.
Yes,
Yeah.
so so I had a reading of it in December, I think maybe, which I directed.
Oh, right. Okay.
But I did have some dramaturgical help from a great PhD friend in the UT program that helped with dramaturgy. But then I moved to New York in February, and then so me and Graham picked it up and started talking about it again.
And I would say, like, even since we graduated, Travis and I started like collaborating on, like, we've applied to some residencies together and have developed some. We had like a Siegel project that we would meet and just generate ideas about, but have never done like a full production process together.
I see. And
So.
then someone decided to do a reading of Queen of the Night, and Graham, you were attached as director.
Yeah, I pitched it to Idify, which is
Oh, Mirror Eyes Company. Yes. Yes.
exactly. And
Okay.
and so she was really excited about it, and that was, I guess, in July. I pitched two projects, and the first one came off famously. It was by another colleague of ours, Lane Michael Stanley. It was called Rainfall Special on Me. It's about the experience of chronic homelessness, and it was fantastic. And that was just as a scheduling matter that I think there was some reason we wanted to do Rain first. And then I was like, all right, so let's saddle up for we knocked it out of the park. Let's think about Queen of the Night. And I just like Mira and I have become friends, and so we were just like kind of geeking out over our success, and and like kind of in passing, she opened up space for this question, which was like, do you think that you're the right director for this piece? And we had already, I had pitched it as the director for the piece, and I think there was always like a voice in the back of my head that was like, I'm very aware I'm not queer. And this is a queer story. I'm not black, and this is a very black story. And like I, that's when I, and it was just like opening space for a question, like what makes you the perfect director? And I went away, and the next meeting that I had was with Travis and Mirai to talk about the project. And in the interim, I just thought a lot about this question and
Yeah.
that.
And when did you pose the question to Travis?
It was in this meeting with Mirai and Travis that we came together.
And so, Travis, what was your response to the question when it was asked?
So I think, since you and Mirai talked about it, Mirai posed the question as kind of an organizational question. So I was like, I don't know, I guess Graham's fine. And then the next question was, I think, more directed, which was like, do you want a black director to direct this? And I mean, I honestly didn't know what to think. I was like, yes, of course. But the way the question was posed was kind of, I was on the spot. And so I was like, okay, like Graham's in the Zoom room. Like we can mute him, but like he can still hear us. If I'm like, Graham's a bad choice. But once I mean, in the few, I think I responded this way. I said, I don't, I that I that idea, that's the first idea that I want. Like, that's the first thing I want, is to work with a Black director. I really want to work with a Black director. I haven't in the past had the chance to work with a Black director, not in grad school, not after grad school. So that's something that's really important to me. And I think I even said I feel like I'm being put on the spot. Like, I don't, so yeah, it was kind
Yeah.
of an awkward, weird thing, but it worked out good.
Yeah. I wanna find out how it worked out, but I also wanna talk to you, Travis, about. I'm gonna say this back to you, all through college and grad school as a playwright, and now post grad school, until now, you had never worked with a Black director. On any of your plays.
Not any of the plays I wrote. I might have worked with some Black directors as an actor, but I mean, I was in Austin, Texas for about 11 years. Austin, Texas is a mostly white city. The arts, or I know a lot of people of color that are doing art in arts and theater in Austin, but it's the same people. It's my friends. It's the same group. It's,
Sure.
everyone's busy working. That whole story. And even my thesis, I was like, okay, like I told them, like, I'm not going to do this play, because I knew that they wanted me to do that play, even though I'm now like kind of regretting doing that play. But I was like, I need either a queer or Black director. And I was just like, I won't do this play. And I know you want to do this play for your UTNT production. And they gave me a queer director, which Lane was actually the director. He's great, and he worked really hard, but he's white. And so that was my compromise, I guess, because they wouldn't pay for me to get a Black director. So yeah, so grad school, no Black directors. After that, I was in talks with other Black artists to make work in Austin, and that was kind of one of the reasons why I was like, okay, well, I have to move to a major city like New York or LA or Chicago or something,
Yeah.
because this is crazy.
Okay, so then the question was posed. Travis says, "Yes, I would love to work with a Black queer director." Graham, your response to that was you flipped the table and you stormed out of the Zoom room.
No, I mean, I kind of
Of course.
I felt like that it was important to like be really clear that I'm not only okay with this, like I want this for Travis. My wife is a Black playwright. I know how important that can be. I know how transformative that can be, and I also know how in some ways how hard it can people can find themselves in situations where they're in an ecosystem that just does not support or accommodate that. And
Yeah.
I felt like I have been in New York for a couple of years. I know a lot of fantastic, and I had just worked, I did a youth education project at the Goodman, where I was a guest director and I was paired with Wardell Julius Clark and Ken Matt Martin, who are fantastic Chicago, queer Chicago directors. I know. Who are Black, and I know several in the city. And I just felt like between Mira and I, we had an opportunity to kind of leverage our networks to find to and this felt on some in some ways it felt like a low stakes thing. Like, look, we don't know when this production is ever going to happen, and this could be like a really beautiful experience for Travis. And I, that suspicion felt like it was kind of confirmed, and we just kind of immediately started thinking about and and thinking about some names that were close to hand,
Yeah.
and that's how it
And
went.
so so when you stepped back, you stayed, you're on the project still, correct?
Yeah, and that was part of like what mirror I thought of in the moment is like, why don't you be the dramaturg? And that way, like some of the knowledge that I had and the relationship that I had built with Travis and the relationship with the play, I could still, like, that wasn't like cut off or lost.
Yeah.
And I could bring that into the process. And, you know, it was on the one hand, like, I felt really strongly about that, about that this was a great micro reparation, you know, gesture. Yes. Like, yep. It's a, and then it became kind of emotionally difficult because Ken Matt fell in love with the play and confirmed what I had believed, which is this is so cool. It's such a good script.
Yeah.
It had already attracted some interest. And then it became a bit more challenging for me to, because then I had all these feelings about, like, what have I given up? And just to be, like, real, that, like, that's not eventually where I came down, but just, like, I feel like just to, for white people, maybe, like, this is part of the experience, you know? It's not, yeah, just like completely smooth sailing it. There is a feeling of, like, it cost me something. But that just made, then I got the opportunity to reflect it and write about it. And I thought about and checked in with Travis about this, about what it had cost them in grad school to have no opportunity to work with a Black director.
Yeah.
And what that said about, I mean, the kind of, I called it, in this article I wrote, the overwhelming whiteness of our program. It also, yeah, pointed to probably a bit of a leg up that I got just in getting there. So
in that conversation, how was that for you, Travis, when Graham came back to you and said, you know, I'm struggling with this emotionally. What was your response to that?
I think when I actually heard about this was when you proposed the article. And so he was kind of giving me a spill on the article and asking, was it okay to feature, you know, names and our relationship in the article and things like that. And my first initial reaction was, this is fine, I guess. And I think, and I'll go on and I will say this, because I said this to you in text and I don't know if it relayed, but maybe here's some. I think that I was like, oh, well, you know, like, someone's going to drag you for this, right? Like, you have to make it like a certain thing, because, and it's even interesting, and I know the publishers of the articles need to make money and things like that. It is behind a paywall, which I think is interesting, which is a different conversation. I don't think it should be behind a paywall. Two, I think, and I said this, that I think people are going to be like, why they go to the white dude to ask about him put like the Black person getting the thing that they needed, right? And that you needed to lean into, like, actually describing the emotional turmoil or whatever it was that you were feeling. And there was a thing about, I think there was something about a bruise to ego or something like that that was mentioned in the article. And I was like, you need to go deeper in that. Like, because if this is an article saying, hey, here's an example, white people, of how we can make the space equitable, by not just hiring a Black person on the artistic director team and being like, look, we hired Liliana, we're cool now. Like, look, we hired two Black people in our fellowship group this year, even though they already won 10 other fellowships. Like,
right.
But like, but there's a way that you can show people that that getting to equality and creating changes within the theater industry, which is really, really horrible and racist, is by actually these little things where it's like, hey, I'm gonna pass you the name of five directors that you've never heard of that are Black and queer. Here you go. And the meetup between me and Ken Matt Martin was stellar and amazing. And I hope that even if we don't ever work on this project, or if we do, I hope that we can work together again, or I hope I can slide his name to somebody at UT that's in the grad program right now and say, hey, fly this person out, get them to give you money. He's amazing. Like,
yes,
you know, this is a way that actual change can happen.
Yeah.
So, well, I was like, okay.
This is also the way communities are built. is by being vulnerable with one another and being honest about where we are, you know? Travis, I really want to know from you, what is your life like post that conversation? Meeting with a Black director, having said that out loud, all of that stuff. Like, what is your new, is there something, like, was there a breath of fresh air? Like, what is happening with you now in your spirit?
We're still in the process of working together right now. And it's been a brilliant, I mean, Idafy, Mirai, Victoria, everyone in that company and that group has just supported every idea that I have. And that in turn allows me to just speak with confidence. And I think you even mentioned this too as well, Graham, like, via, you know, we're texting back and forth, we're good friends. So like that there's an authority to your voice that maybe was not there or not as clear before. And even, you know, reading that reading that LA article or talking, I got to talk with C.A. Johnson through my playwriting group, and she talked about her experiences with her play at MTC and all this stuff and her work now. And it's about having a little bit of authority to your voice and saying what you need and what you want, and then just keep saying it until somebody gives it to you. And like Mirai and this and Idafy were like, oh yeah, okay, great, who do you want in the play? And yeah. I'm like, somebody from Broadway? And they're like, okay. They're like, we'll call people. I'm like, okay. That makes me endlessly joyful. So
I love that for you. I love that for you.
I had gotten a microdose of, like, part of what also gave me a bit of confidence is, you know, Travis, when they moved to New York, one of the first things that we did, because, and I wasn't the only one, but I talked about my amazing friend Travis, who's about to move here, to a lot of people. And one of them is Garlia Jones.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, who runs a Blackboard reading group. And so somebody told Garlia about Travis, who was not me. And then, so she was like, well, we got to get this guy, we got to get Travis in here. And so the microdose was, because all the contexts in which I had seen Travis were in predominantly white spaces. And that was really the first time that I saw you surrounded by just a completely receptive, supportive group of Black artists who were like, Travis, what do you need? No, Travis, speak up. Like, Travis, like, tell us what's in your heart. And it and it's not to say that authority had never been there, but like, that was a moment where I saw you kind of puff up, and I was like, this, and you know, so I knew that this is hitting at like a really visceral level. That was just an experience that made a deep impression on me. I remember how fancy and fly you felt after that.
Fancy and fly.
Same.
Come on, fancy and fly. That is what we want.
That's what we want.
Grown and sexy. That should be the theme of everything. Thank you both very much for coming on the show. I am really impressed that your friendship has become deeper and your colleagueship has also become deeper. I'm really, really impressed by that. I'm impressed also by the passion with which you shared your expression with me today. Really, thank you. I'm really inspired. I want to say, just from personal experience, that, you know, I grew up in the track where I was around a lot of white people all the time. My family is all Black, but in high school and stuff, all of my classes were all white people. And when I got to college and somebody knocked on my door and gave me a card that said, come to the Black Student Alliance meeting, I was like, what? No, I'm not doing that. And then a friend of mine on my hall, who is Arab, said, no, you have to go to the meeting. You have to go. Go join the Black Student Alliance. Go. You have to go. Go. And so I went to the meeting, and it was my first experience, I think, as a queer kid in the South, who talked like this. It was my first experience being around, and also, I have a brother who used to be really awful to me and racially. He's black too, but he used to say things about how black people didn't like me. That's tea to brew for later. But it was my first experience being around a group of black people who wanted me to succeed. In my mind, it was the first time that I knew that people were showing love in a way that was demonstrative and different from, and I loved it and couldn't, I couldn't get enough. But I also know that most black people, a lot of black artists, have this feeling of we're not black enough for them. I'm too black for them, but I'm not black enough for them. And that has always been a personal bugaboo for me, but not anymore. It might be because I'm in my 50s now, but I'm recognizing how much I love other people's blackness and how much I really love my own, and how I want to create a space in the world for other black people to just know that they're accepted and as beautiful as they are. And I also only have white friends who are the same way in terms of my blackness. I don't have white friends who think I'm too black or not black enough. And I don't have white colleagues who think that either. At least I don't think of them as colleagues, because I don't, So I'm just so proud of the two of you for having gone through this and for making your work relationship really even deeper. Graham, do you want to talk about those tears?
It just means a lot to me. Like, one of the things that I realized that made it really hard is that I stepped away from this collaboration, and it was then that I realized like how much it really meant to me when Travis chose me as a director, and that was just your friendship that apropos of my earlier statement that I'm riddled with doubt about how lovable I am, I just chose to look at it and accept it as like a gesture that had love in it. And that I, yeah, but I and I feel like that's that connection is still there, and I got to reciprocate it in a particular way.
I just wanted to, I think the vocabulary of step down or step back may be the wrong vocabulary, right? Like you're saying, like I showed you a gesture by being like, I want you to direct my play, but I think that like the gesture of love is like tenfold by you like handing over or guiding or some other than step back or step. It's a more loving gesture, I think. And I think maybe think about it that way.
Oh, you guys, okay. Oh, I'm gonna end this video because I just love you both so much. And I think the best way to end this is on that gesture of love. That was lovely. Thank you so much for coming on the show to talk to me. And I can't wait to see Queen of the Night.